1877-1932, and Kabbalah. It sounds very general, but it's pioneering study. There is no study about impact of Kabbalah on Volozhin. So, the decadent poet, literary critic, and painter Maximilian Volozhin, known in particular as a poet, occupies a very special position in Russian intellectual history and conscience. So, and I'll say some dull and words about such person. Found highly esteemed, Volozhin was well known and influential during his lifetime. While his texts were suspicious for the Soviet authorities, they were completely banned only for a short term. However, his main works were not started to republish in the Soviet Union until the end of the 80s, the time of Perestroika. His political worldview was quite original, and he himself was obviously distanced from clear political sympathies for special, for specific political parties and movements. Such a position secured both circulation of his works in the Soviet Union and his popularity as being an official, not a completely Soviet poet. At the same time, Volozhin's house was a famous vacation place for countless poets, artists, actors, scientists, and wanderers, eventually becoming a museum. During the Soviet period, it acquired the role of celebrated goal for pilgrimage of the Russian intelligentsia. Thus, being known especially as a poet, Volozhin had a great impact on intellectual life, but his influence was not entirely connected only to poor poetry. It was mingled with the clear interest in his way of life. His poetry in its ideological context, I can recommend a book about his position in Russian culture, modern culture. It's a book by Barbara Walker, Maximilian Volozhin and the Russian Literary Circle, Culture and Survival in Revolutionary Times. Okay. These commonly noted facts reflect only a partial reality, truly. Volozhin's poetry presents an original ideology. His rhymed works have many themes in common with his prosaic texts. Certainly, there is a methodological approach. Volozhin usually started from writing a text of a poem in prose with the intention of rhyming it afterward. But moreover, his poems also reflect more elaborate and sophisticated ideas which are enclosed within their very core. However, Volozhin gives a justification to poetry that does not completely reflect the truth of the occult. Adepts have their own functions in the world. These functions are quite different from the creation of literary works. Poet should describe his intuition rather than declare utter truth. Volozhin wrote in his letter to Alexandra Petrova, December 2nd, 1930, that if poet must depict no less than highest truth, only adept may be a poet, but quite similar spheres of creativity exist for adept. Sorry, it's my translation of the quotation. Probably it isn't good enough. In spite of the fact that Volozhin's library and his diaries are known, the sources of his ideas could not be easily detected and classified. The main cause is Volozhin's originality and inaccuracy in the application of data. He much relied on his own experience in his interpretation of the texts. Volozhin himself, being a polymath, a man of impressive erudition, is very inimical in his attitude to formal systematic education. It's worth mentioning some characteristics of his personality from the memoir of widely known translator, Evgenia Gertzik, 1878-1944. The very similar remarks may also be found in the texts of other authors. So, she writes, historical anecdotes, clever parallels, occult intuition. On this Volochin built his concept many years ago and later, at a mature age. And so, also on that way, something can be found. Gertzik also mentioned an interesting dialogue between Volochin and his first wife, Margarita Sabashnikova. So, the quotation. Margarita pressed him aside. Oh, Max, you get everything confused. But he does not surrender. But Amory, it's a name for that Volochin used in the conversation with Margarita, instead of Margarita. But Amory, only from such confusion a meaning may appear. Volochin read an ample amount of occult books, and his interest in occult topics is apparent. The main foundations of his occult knowledge are widely known. First of all, he was an active Freemason. Secondly, he personally was a pupil of Rudolf Steiner, a head of German section of the Theosophical Society, and later founder of an Anthroposophical Society. Also, Volochin was a pupil of Anna Mintsova, a very popular figure in that period in the Russian Empire, a theosophist, a follower of Elena Blavatsky. But also, he has his personal experience and original worldview. Evidently, Volochin believed in the complete coincidence of his ideas and Steiner's teaching, anthroposophy. For instance, in the letter to Margarita Sabashnikova, it's October the 24th, 1905, he said that the ideas which she presents to him as the ideas of Steiner, he had felt from his childhood. In the letter to Yulia Abalenskaya, it's May the 19th, 1915, he confesses, I know that even before the encounter with anthroposophy, I have thought completely in its terms, and I shall change no further such a way of thinking. However, Sabashnikova saw this issue from the opposite side. In her memoir titled Green Snake, The Green Snake, she remarked, from anthroposophy, Marx takes the things which are closest to him. Volochin was quite an original occult thinker, much indebted to theosophy, anthroposophy, and Freemasonry. But at the same time, he believed that the declaration of the utter truth is the business of adept alone. He believed that he, as a poet and an artist, may freely use occult knowledge without any particular endeavor for accuracy. Such a position makes a study of the impact of Kabbalah on Volochin a very difficult task. This deserves a lengthy study, which will include analysis of Volochin's marginalia in the books from his impressive private library. This brief preliminary research will only depict the general problem and present its main aspects. Another one of the main problems of such investigation is the precise definition of Kabbalah. It's a commonly known, commonly acknowledged problem here. Really, the term means a tradition in Hebrew, and this philosophical tradition in Judaism has never possessed one so comprehensive doctrine. Rather, it was a living teaching with considerable variations from the Renaissance search for ancient texts, a curiosity for Kabbalah originates. But the Christian version of Kabbalah became a part of European occult and magical tradition, quite different from the original Jewish Kabbalah. Such a marked difference provokes to declare this tradition as not genuine. But I'm sorry. Andreas Kircher, as an answer to the remark of Moshe Eden, noted, sorry, you are here. And I would like to refer to the article by Andreas Kircher. Andreas Kircher noted that in reality both versions of the Kabbalah are distinct traditions, thus neither one of them can be depicted as false. Thus, there is an important question: how can we divide between Kabbalah and occult tradition in the works of Voloshin, since there is also no particular consent toward the definition of Kabbalah? It seems that the best way to do it is to analyze some of his own remarks on Kabbalah itself with an attempt to show the character of Voloshin sources and his mode of work with them. To start the discussion on the impact itself, let us mention Voloshin's lecture, The Ways of Errors. It's famous and widely known text with many parallels in other works by Voloshin. It was first presented on February 27, 1907, at the Moscow Society of Literature and Art, Moskovsky Художественный Литературный Кружок. This text may be defined as entirely a cult, theoretical, original work. It marks Voloshin's occult worldview in the beginning of its evolution. So both the plan of the lecture and its entire text are known and published. Here Voloshin clearly refers to Kabbalah. He even appeals to the Sefer Zohar. But the source of Voloshin's cosmogony have nothing in common with Jewish Kabbalah. Let us briefly represent his theory. Voloshin describes the creation of the world. On a certain level, the images appear. Voloshin called them Sephiroth's Eons Elohims. They are gods without sex. Voloshin gives some examples of them: Zeus, Venus, Horus. They created man. Man was a robot without free will. But Lucifer gave to man knowledge of good and evil. It saved man and opened to him an opportunity to leave Elohim and become a God himself. The precept of Bible, be fruitful and multiply, leads back to Elohim. The evil angel is closer to Christ than Elohim. But the man is closer to Jesus than angel. He speaks about sex. It was a popular discussion in the society of Russian Empire of that period. It was a very popular topic, but in the case of Voloshin, he answered to the problem which was discussed in the works of another decadent poet of that period, Vyacheslav Ivanov. The source of aforementioned cosmogony may be easily found in this case. Blavatsky, in her Secret Doctrine, describes a very similar theory. Rudolf Steiner uses it in his lectures, particularly developing the role of Lucifer. Actually, this name, Lucifer, also became a title of his magazine. Voloshin personally studied with Steiner, so the poet may have heard and absorbed such theories from his teacher. However, he evidently also read and studied the secret doctrine of Blavatsky. By the time of the composition of the lecture, he remarked in his notebook to read the secret doctrine. There is no date on this notebook. Probably it was written, it's described as written between 1905-1907, but I will show that it was written in 1905 because also in his letter to his first wife, Margarita Sabashnikova, he mentioned these books. On September 1905, he writes, "I read the secret doctrine." In this letter, Voloshin specially notes that the problems of the history of man and life are about sex. But he also legitimized his own interpretations by saying that everything in this book is merely hints. On September 1905, he writes, "The secret doctrine said much about that." He explains that he means development or evolution from God and afterward back towards God. In the same lecture, Voloshin gives a Kabbalistic axiom. A stone becomes a plant. A plant, a beast. A beast, a man. A man, a spirit. A spirit, God. Here is the description of the path and direction of God's light. First, it came down into matter, and through the aforementioned hierarchy, it returns to its source. Evidently, this concept is also brought from Blavatsky. This Kabbalistic axiom appears in her main works. In the Secret Doctrine, second book, first part, stanza 8. And in the Isis Unveiled, first volume, chapters 9 and 11. This phrase became a starting point, a main assertion of Voloshin's article, another article, Archaism in Russian Painting, first published in magazine Apollo, first number, 1909. This is an article about some painters. Voloshin was himself a prominent painter, and especially in the history of art. However, here he apparently shows the occult foundation of his thinking. He speaks about three painters: Nikolai Rerich, known also as Rerich, 1874. 1947, Konstantin Bogoyevsky, 1872-1943, and Leon Bakst, his real name was Lev Rosenberg, 1866-1924. The main idea is this: archaism is an agenda of modern art. Actually, in the 19th century, people discovered archaism through the rapid development of archaeology. But it's also the turning point in history, which may be described as waking up. The dream was broken, and once awoken, man misses it. In this article, Rerich represents the Stone Age in history, North, and Stone in the Kabbalistic axiom. Bogoyevsky is Soul, the migration period and wars. He is linked with Earth as a sphere. He is plant of the Kabbalistic axiom. Bakst is above the Earth, linked to the Minoan civilization and Atlantis, having much in common with the European culture of the 18th century. He is man of Kabbalistic axiom. Though not clearly pronounced, it may be presumed that Voloshin speaks about the process of return to God, signs of which he sees in art. So, for Voloshin, the simple Kabbalistic passages became the foundation of the understanding of the world. It's also noteworthy that Voloshin borrowed from the motley sympathies of Blavatsky only a brief remark, which he regarded as Kabbalistic. And such truth may hint at Voloshin's special interest in Jewish part of philosophical wisdom. So let us search for usages of some other Kabbalistic sources. The question, is the entire Kabbalistic knowledge of Voloshin based on Steiner and Blavatsky, or did he himself try to deepen his knowledge of Kabbalah? Surely, Voloshin attempt to go ad fontes, to the sources. While his point of departure was the writings of Blavatsky and Steiner, he shows a clear inclination to go further. He read books on Kabbalah. In his library, there are many classical books on Christian Kabbalah, such as, for instance, those of Paracelsus. He is not a Kabbalist, but there is an impact on Kabbalah on his work. So partly can say that there is some part of Kabbalah within his teaching. Eliphas Levi, Robert Flatt, but does Voloshin go to its Hebrew sources? He did not know Hebrew on a proper level, but he tried to master this language. He used a textbook by Eshal, published in Warsaw in 1904. It can be found in his library. He refers to two books which certainly deal with Jewish Kabbalah, but is not fully. Antoine Faber d'Olivet, 1768-1825, the Hebrew language, and the book of Adolf Frank, the Kabbalah. Probably they were his main sources. He much writes about them in his notebooks and letters. Faber d'Olivet definitely has considerable impact on Voloshin. Voloshin not only recall him. In his notebook, Voloshin speculates on the combinations of the Hebrew letters borrowed from d'Olivet. But there is something more than remarks in Voloshin's notebook. The poet applies Kabbalistic speculations on Hebrew letters as his main argument and point of departure in one of his articles. Methodology, not the something that he took from the book of d'Olivet. So the title of the article is "Culture, Art, Monuments of Crimea." Культура искусства памятники Крыма. The poet interprets the name of the Crimean peninsula, which is Crimea in Russian, Skimeria. Skimeria is a Greek name of the big region, which includes Crimea. Voloshin believes that this name derives from Jewish root, cave Memresh. According to Voloshin, it's darkness, eclipse, ghost place, castle, threat. Actually, I checked d'Olivet. There is a separate section in the book with Hebrew roots and their interpretation. There is no such thing, I don't know. But the source, probably I missed it somewhere. I'm looking for it. But that is really interesting that such assertion became a starting point for Voloshin's this course about the history and culture of region. Voloshin, another very interesting story, living story. Voloshin accompanied a blind Orthodox Jew, Ruvim Azar, from Paris to Berlin in 1912, who related Hasidic stories on their trip. These stories deeply impressed Voloshin. He notes them in his letter to Petrovsky, March the 14th, 1912. Voloshin certainly united them with his knowledge on Kabbalah. The unclear reference to this comes from, with the phrase, "Remember the Kabbalah of Frank," which appears in a brief record of a dream. The story of this record is very interesting. In 1926, Voloshin received a treatment of Dr. Lifshitz, a follower of Sigmund Freud. And there are some data descriptions of the dreams. The mentioned dreams appears with date. It's July the 25th. Sorry. The key to the development of Voloshin's knowledge of Kabbalah may be his poem Space, Cosmos, composed in 1923. This brief text is of special importance. It's among Voloshin's latest poetical works. Thus, it may reflect Voloshin's final ideas and the author himself emphasized the importance of this brief text. Voloshin writes about it to Yulia Abalinskaya, December 25th, 1923, that he gave here a description of the evolution of cosmogonies and the structure of the entire world from ancient Kabbalah up to the theory of relativity and modern physics. The main direction of the development is not very clear. It's a cult poem, and it should be grasped. But there is a clear accent on the progression of it starts from creation of the world, so spirit, man, beast, plant, stone, and afterward, it appears as stone, plant, beast, man, spirit. So they return to God. It's mentioned, axiom borrowed from Blavatsky. Thus, probably, in spite of Voloshin's interest in Jewish Kabbalah, the foundation of his Kabbalistic theories remain unchanged. They are based on Blavatsky.
Thank you.
That's all.
Thank you very much, Evgeny. We are running late, but I think can take a couple of questions.
It was so dull.
Yes.
I would like to know the details of the influence of Dorybe. I think you mentioned the name of Pavel Dorybe. I would like to know the details of the influence of Dorybe on Voloshin.
They are quite different. Actually, Dorybe was also he wrote prose, and but he wrote a special Kabbalistic work on Kabbalah. He studied Jewish sources, and in the case of Voloshin, for Voloshin it wasn't so important. He was first of all a poet, and his Kabbalistic interests were very practical, actually. He used them, applied them, but he was not a Kabbalist. He don't even knew Hebrew on good level. He speculates about Hebrew, history of Hebrew language. He wrote a book on Hebrew language. And in the case of Voloshin, Voloshin only studied Hebrew language, but he didn't know it on the good level.
Are you able to separate out the Kabbalistic influence from the general Blavatskyan corpus in which that Kabbalistic material is reabsorbed? I should be able to say that, but it's
About the sources of Blavatsky?
Well, I mean, if the Kabbalah is in Blavatsky, is it just in the bottom, the sort of the bottom line? He's a neo-Blavatskyan, and the Kabbalah that is in his work, you're saying, is all to be found in Madame Blavatsky's work. There isn't really
the main axiom that appears in the works of Voloshin through his entire life. Yes, he borrowed it from Blavatsky, but he also has quite different sources. Mm-hmm. What is more important, that Voloshin, for Voloshin, this part of the occult knowledge was very important. Mm-hmm. For Blavatsky, I feel so, that it isn't.
The Kabbalah is important in Blavatsky,
It was part, but the main part of her teaching was, at least she declared that it was from Hinduism and mm-hmm. Buddhism, mm-hmm. From different sources. It was part of her teaching, but I feel that it isn't an important part.
So he made it important. He took emphasized something that's in Blavatsky,
yes.
But you say secondary in Blavatsky.
It's a quite different topic. His relationships with Jews. Mm-hmm. Most of his friends were Jews. So. Was in quite different situation. He spent his childhood in Theodosia, in Crimea, uh-huh. He notes in his notebook that most of his friends were Jews, mm-hmm. because they were more educated than the other parts of the society of
there. Interesting. Thank you again. You were mentioned in the lecture. You get to ask the question. We go back.
I'm just curious about one aspect. You mentioned that he was interested in Kabbalah also in a practical sense, not only concepts. But I wonder what are these practical aspects? For example, it could be interesting if he could use Kabbalah as a technique of writing. Especially if he's interested in the linguistic aspect, starting with Favo d'Olivet and others. So that would be interesting if Kabbalah would get a kind of a technique of avant-gardistic writing techniques.
For Voloshin, I think so, yes. In private life also, he used prayers, for example, in the time of revolution. It was a very difficult time, and he recalled in his notebooks that he used a prayer to achieve something. to save somebody. It was very, very, very practical in the sense of in the part of studies of Bible, he used Kabbalah and his studies about on art, literature, and he used it in poetry. The concepts, ideas from Kabbalah he used in his poetry. And also he used it in his private life.
Okay. Thank you.